The last of the Orwell Prize events that have been going on all week, and this evening the title is Losing Russia? Question mark. And for that we have a narrator, so I'll be brief. We have, posing the motion as it were, we have Edward Lucas, who's a long-time journalist on The Economist, has had a very distinguished career, mostly in Eastern Europe. He's Eastern Central Europe correspondent there, and he's been in the area for the last two decades. And he did a book about a year ago called New Cold War, which has had a great success and has been very controversial, and I hope will be again controversial this evening. On Edward's left is Alex Prada of this university, of St. Anthony's College, who is one of the great experts, a world expert, on foreign policy of Russia and, before that, the Soviet Union. And the book that he is now finishing is on Mikhail Gorbachev's foreign policy from 1985 to 1991. To my far right is Owen Matthews, who's the bureau chief for Newsweek in Moscow now, and has written a very well regarded, very well reviewed book called Stalin's Children, which tells the story of the Cold War love affair and indeed in his own family. And finally, to my right is Mark Leonard, who is executive director of the European Council on Foreign Relations. He is the only one who's not a Russia expert, he's a Chinese expert. So he's also written a book called Why Europe Will Run the 21st Century. And he may explain why. It's having a rather slow start in running the 21st century. We've all got at most 5 minutes, National Grant. My knuckles sharply on the table when we go over that. But first we'll start with Edward, who will propose the motion.
Well, thanks very much indeed, John, and we're going to try and manufacture some disagreement among four people who I suspect actually grew up quite a lot of things. I suppose that there are two main charges to the idea that the West has lost Russia. But I would start off by saying I think the whole idea is ridiculous, that Russia was not the West's to lose. I did not lost means, and ultimately the responsibility for what happens to Russia is in the hands of the Russian people and Russian politicians. So the idea that Russia is some kind of plaything that the West has carelessly lost, I think, is conceptually flawed anyway. But the two main things that the West is supposed to have got wrong is, one, that we force-fed the Russian economy capitalist ideas in the 1990s, which damaged it, and the second is that we somehow humiliated Russia by expanding NATO into Eastern Europe and the former Soviet Union, and that this somehow justifies Russia's imperialist and xenophobic, chauvinistic, and generally hostile language and sometimes behaviour since. I think those are both basically flawed, and you don't have to be a professor of economics or geopolitics to see why. The Russian economy in 1991 was in a terrible mess. The printing presses had been running absolutely full blast as the Soviet Union collapsed, and there was an enormous, what economists call, monetary overhang. And really the only thing to do was to liberalise prices, and unfortunately that brought home the fact that the printing presses had been running red hot, and a lot of people realised that then that the savings that they thought existed in their bank accounts were just numbers on a bit of paper and not real money, but the real destruction of savings had happened earlier. One can argue about the sequence and the timing of the privatisation and other things that happened, but I think that any quibbles one has about that, and one can certainly argue things could have been done differently, are dwarfed by the problems that the Russian economy already faced as a result of the collapse of central planning. And ultimately, the really big change that happened was not that that Russia stopped adopting Western shock therapy, but that Russia benefited from a high oil price, which brought in 1.3 trillion in extra oil and gas revenues, which the ex-KGB regime in the Kremlin since 1999 has squandered. And on NATO expansion, again, I don't think that the historical record shows that the West did anything wrong. What actually happened was that NATO expansion was not on the agenda in the early 90s, and then as Russia appeared to be less friendly, less democratic, less of a good neighbour than we had hoped in the early Yeltsin years, countries began to get worried. And the more Russia said that NATO expansion would be impermissible, to use a favourite phrase of Yevgeny Primakov, the more the countries that lay in between NATO and Russia began to think they'd better join quickly while they still could, and the moral case for letting them in became stronger. And in fact, I would argue that NATO expansion has been a thoroughly good thing, and thank goodness that, for example, the Baltic states were in NATO by the time of the Georgian War and not still outside it, because history suggests that grey zones and clashes of spheres of interest are much more dangerous than countries being anchored in strong security alliances when they are in those alliances voluntarily. The real problem, people who've lost Russia, have been the rulers of Russia, because they allowed the authoritarian and imperialist ghosts back out of the closet into political life, rehabilitating Stalin, for example, who's now in Russian official textbooks described as a strong leader who took tough decisions for the benefit of the country and helped them win the war. No mention of all the dreadful things that Stalin actually did, not least his appalling incompetence, which almost meant that they lost the war once it started. And insofar as we've lost something, I think what we've lost is our moral authority in the West. And what really annoys me about this ex-KGB regime in the Kremlin is not so much their incredible incompetence, the fact that the paved road network in Russia is now smaller than when they took power in 2000. It's not so much the corruption, the tens of billions of dollars which they're stealing from the Russian people every year. What really annoys me is they're doing it with our consent. It is our law firms that make this look legal. It is our accountants that sign off on the cooked books of these companies. It is our banks that launder this these flows of money into offshore accounts and companies in places like the British Virgin Islands, a crown dependency, where we don't even know who owns the companies there that are channeling these vast sums. And worst of all, perhaps it's our politicians who go along with this and say it's okay. And if there's one word I could leave you with at the end of this, it would be schrödingerizacja, a made-up word, not really Russian, not really German, but reflecting the way in which the former German Chancellor, in his final months in office, signed off on a gas pipeline on the Baltic seabed that was so threatening to Poland's energy security that the then Polish Defence Minister described it as the energy version of the Molotov-Ribbentrop Pact, and then only months after leaving office took a lucrative job as chairman of that consortium. Sadly, that is not the only example of this. There are plenty more. So what we have lost is our moral authority. And the problem with that... No, you're trying to shut me up.
No, I'm saying I
can't get it. And the problem with that is that when this ex-KGB regime in Russia, which is so corrupt and so incompetent, hits the buffers, as I'm sure it will, that the Russian people who back in 1989-91 were in no doubt that as communism, the planned economy had failed, that they wanted multi-party democracy, rule of law, political freedom and the whole Western package, I think now we'll be a lot less enthusiastic about that, because we have, by our own greed and laziness, tainted a model to which they once used to look up.